Trapped. Mede mogelijk gemaakt door Radio Veronica.
On the 13th of October 1972, a Uruguayan rugby team is traveling from Montevideo to Santiago in Chile for a tournament. On the way, the plane hits turbulence and the pilots stray off course.
This is your captain speaking. Please fasten your seatbelt.
Among the team members on board is 22-year-old Nando Parrado. Two of the 45 passengers and crew survived the crash. One of the lucky ones is 18-year-old Carlitos Paez.
The first thing I noticed when I stepped out of the fuselage was the white scenery, surrounded by mountains, then the cold.
No one knows where the plane has crashed. They're surrounded by mountains with little food or drink. And at an altitude of 4,000 meters, the temperature is below freezing. To survive, a group of young men will be forced to break the most sacred of human taboos. It will become one of the most remarkable and terrifying survival stories of the 20th century. When the plane doesn't arrive in Santiago, the Chilean Air Force launches a search and rescue mission. Jorge Massa is the joint commander of the rescue operation.
Initially, an investigation into a crash should be based on a flight path. The search begins at the last known point and works backward from there.
The Chilean Air Force searches along the scheduled flight path, but it finds nothing.
The first night was horrible. People screaming, people dying, the cold, very brutal cold. For many of us, it was the first time we had seen a dead person.
By the next day, four more people have died. Among them is co-pilot Dante Laguirara. There are now 28 passengers still alive. The immediate danger for these survivors is hypothermia, which can occur when the body is exposed to cold. As the body temperature drops, blood vessels close to the surface of the skin constrict, reducing blood flow to the extremities. This preserves the body's core temperature and protects the vital organs. Continued exposure reduces nerve and motor functions, heart rate and breathing decrease, and slowly the body shuts down. Carlito's father is the first family member to arrive at the rescue headquarters in Chile.
I came to speak with Commander Massa. My name is Carlos Páez Hilardo.
Okay, atento.
Porque yo sabía que de ninguna manera aquel Carlito Miguel, que era mi hijo, me iba a fallar.
I knew that there was no way that my son Carlitos would fail me when we'd had so many adventures together and been so close.
A famous painter at home in Uruguay, Carlos has crossed the continent to find his son.
Hello, Commander Mas.
Carlos Páez.
From the beginning, Carlos Páez had the drive, courage, and determination to find his son.
Massa takes the unusual step of allowing Carlos to take part in the search operation.
We spent hours circling the mountains. I prayed for my son with tears in my eyes, not knowing if it was from the pain of the search or the reflection of the snow.
After 3 days on the mountain, the 28 survivors are growing weak from hunger. They ration 8 chocolate bars, some sweets and dried fruit, a packet of salted crackers, and 3 small jars of jam between them.
The plane.
Oh my God.
Down here!
Down here!
Down here!
The wind jet! It's a signal! There's so much!
Carlitos and the others are sure they've been spotted, but they're wrong.
The problem that many search parties encounter when searching from a plane is that it's difficult to distinguish objects from the glare of the surrounding snow. In this case, the plane was buried in the snow, so we were never going to see it.
Nando Parado has been unconscious with a broken skull since the crash. But on the third day, he wakes up.
Where's my mom?
Also on board the doomed flight were Nando's mother and younger sister, Susie.
Where's my mom?
Nando's teammate, 19-year-old Roberto Canessa, breaks the news.
Nando. I'm so sorry. Your mother died
inside. Roberto tells Nando that his mother died in the crash and that her body is buried outside with the others. He implores Nando to stay calm so he can help his sister, who's still alive but badly injured.
Susie!
Where is she?
Susie! Susie! Susie!
Susie era mi hermana menor.
Susie was my younger sister. We always got along very well. When I realized that my sister was in the front section of the fuselage, she became my priority.
Nando's sister is seriously ill with internal injuries.
The only thing I could do for her was to keep her warm by hugging her.
Posible era darle calor, estar abrazado con.
It's okay. It's okay, Sus. It'll
be okay.
The boys scavenge through the wreckage of the plane, searching for anything that might help keep them alive. The desperate circumstances force them to be creative.
That'll work.
Although surrounded by snow, Nando and the others are suffering from dehydration.
La sed.
The thirst at that altitude is exactly the same as the one you can feel in the middle of the desert, in the Sahara. You dehydrate a lot faster than at sea level.
Dehydration happens when a person's breathing rate increases. To get sufficient oxygen from the thin atmosphere, Nando needs to breathe more quickly, and that expends more moisture than normal. What Nando and the others don't realize is that eating snow also robs the body of valuable energy and heat and accelerates the process of hypothermia. Ingesting snow rapidly cools the mouth, and when it's swallowed, the cold water lowers the body's temperature. To restore warmth to the mouth and body uses up valuable heat and energy.
With no protection from the cold and wind, your lips start to break and bleed. And if you put snow in your mouth, it hurts a lot. It was a double torture, the thirst plus the pain of putting snow on your destroyed lips. But there was no other way.
Carlitos tries to melt snow by shaking it, but this burns precious energy and proves exhausting.
The solution came about when someone discovered a way to make water, drop by drop.
The survivors discover that every seat back contains an aluminium sheet. They fold the metal sheets to create a makeshift funnel.
You put a thin layer of snow on the aluminium sheet, and the sun melted that layer into a tin can. And once that can was filled, we'd all take turns taking a sip of water.
Despite severe rationing, they're running out of food, and starvation is making everyone weak.
Carlito.
Nando quietly confides in his friend Carlitos.
You awake? Yeah. I'm gonna climb up the mountain.
Nando has become obsessed with the idea of walking out of the mountains to freedom. But Carlitos doesn't take him seriously and insists that Nando is too weak from hunger even to think about it.
We have to eat something or we're gonna die. Carlito. I'm gonna cut meat off one of the pilots.
Their hunger has forced the survivors to think about cannibalism. Some of them have even mentioned it out loud. But the idea is still so alien and so forbidden that no one's yet prepared to act on it.
God help us all. I've been thinking the same thing. No, it doesn't matter. We need to get the battery out of the back of the plane.
After five days, there's still no sign of rescue.
Hey.
Using snowshoes made of strapping and seat cushions, Roberto, Carlitos, and two friends now plan a trek up the mountain in search of the plane's missing tail.
Nuestra obsesión era encontrar la cola del avión, porque en la cola del avión estaba no solamente todo el equipaje, tail, todas las
because
valijas,
that's where all the
sino que además estaban las baterías
and also the batteries
de la,
to power the plane's
del avión,
radio.
Que nos daban la posibilidad de juntarlo al radio transmisor.
Be careful, all right? We will. We'll be back before you know
if
it.
They can find the tail, the boys hope to bring back the plane's battery, which they can use to power up the cockpit radio and send a distress call. Meanwhile, Nando studies a map from the cockpit, trying to work out an escape route from the mountains. He thinks he's worked out where the plane crashed, not too far from the Chilean foothills.
That means that we're really close to the Chilean foothills. If we can get over that mountain.
Nando believes that only one mountain stands between him and safety.
We thought we were very close to Chile. Chile was to the west, and if we climbed that mountain, we would be saved.
After trekking for hours, Carlitos and the boys return to the safety of the fuselage. They fail to find the tail section of the plane.
Everything was against us. We were walking in snow waist-deep, struggling because of the lack of oxygen and because we were so weak, and the cold, unimaginable. Human beings cannot imagine how unbearable it was.
All of them are frozen, exhausted, and defeated. For Nando Parrado, day 8 is devastating. After a painful struggle, his sister Susie dies.
The only thing that comforted me was that she died peacefully in my arms, and she wasn't alone. After my sister died, I felt a change, a very important change. There was an inner voice that was instinct or heart or will, I don't know how to describe it, that told me, I have to go on. You have to move forward. You cannot cry. You can't destroy yourself morally or emotionally. You have to fight to survive.
Finally, the food runs out.
The last thing I ate was a peanut covered in chocolate. I made it last for 3 days.
The survivors are slowly starving to death. Since the crash, Nando's body has tapped into the limited energy reserve stored in his liver. To keep him alive, his body is feeding off itself by breaking down fat deposits and muscle tissue into protein and energy. As his fat and muscle tissue are depleted, his body will become increasingly weak, and vital organs such as the kidneys, lungs, and heart will eventually fail. Unless Nando can find a new source of protein and energy, he and the rest of the survivors will die.
We tried everything that we could possibly eat. Pieces of leather, pieces of shoes, pieces of wood, even hair gel, but there was nothing.
Guys, listen up!
Roberto Canessa, A medical student and respected leader is the first one to broach the taboo subject.
We are starving.
His message is blunt and urgent. They're all dying of starvation. Their only hope is protein, and there's only one way to get it.
Soon, we will die. And the only protein here is in the bodies of our friends. If you want to see your families again, then this is what we must do.
Roberto
Canessa was very important because he was a medical student and he said, if we want to survive, we have to do it. And you have to be in that place, at that moment, in that position, with that fear, that feeling of abandonment, to understand that decision.
At first, not all the survivors will eat human flesh. But eventually, they all do. The flesh provides enough protein to keep them alive. The survivors find a transistor radio and rig up an antenna. They search the airwaves for any news of rescue efforts. They're stunned to hear that they've been given up for dead and the search has been called off.
The moment I heard they called off the search, I knew we were going to die there. No food, no water, no rescue. We were trapped. And I told myself, rather than dying slowly here, I would prefer to die fighting.
Nando is convinced that he must climb the mountain to find help.
I knew I was going to leave, but I was afraid of going alone. Without realizing it, I began to analyze the boys. I was thinking, with this one, I can go. With this one, I cannot. Yes, no. Slowly, the list got smaller.
Nando wants just one man as a climbing partner, Roberto.
I got along with Roberto very well. He was a leader. He worked hard, and he had courage. I asked him to come with me.
Although the official search has been called off, Carlos Paez refuses to give up his personal quest to find his son Carlitos. He travels from village to village, asking everyone he meets if they've seen any signs of a plane crash.
Señor. Ah, ¿cuántos kilómetros son? Ya. ¿Un kilómetro y medio, me dijo?
Claro, hay una baja grande que hay ahí y toma para el lado, para la derecha. Cuando guste, señor.
Muchas gracias.
His search makes him a legend in the region.
And that's where we started hearing, there goes that crazy old man who's still looking for his son that's lost in the mountains.
On their 17th night in the fuselage, the survivors hear a terrifying sound. An avalanche has started down the mountain. It's gathering speed and heading straight for them. The avalanche buries most of the 27 survivors, including Nando Parrado.
I felt like I had 1,000 tons of concrete on my chest. I couldn't breathe anymore.
Eight people die in the avalanche, including 25-year-old Marcelo Perez, the team's captain and leader. For the 19 remaining survivors, morale is now at an all-time low.
The avalanche was an important part of the story, more than you can think. The mountain was definitely trying to kill us one by one, and this increased my desire to leave as quickly as possible.
By day 43, only 17 survivors remain. But there is a small glimmer of hope. A few days earlier, some of the boys finally found the plane's tail section, and in it, the battery for the radio. Nando, Roberto, and two others now return to the tail with the radio and its transmitter. They hope to be able to fix the radio and send out a distress call. Wiring the radio, transmitter, and battery together is extremely complicated, and it will be days before they determine the right connections. Meanwhile, in their continual search for warmth, Nando and his friend Antonio discover a valuable commodity, pieces of insulation.
We didn't have the knowledge, the capacity, the gear. We didn't know how to make it work. We just had hope.
Roberto has been counting on the radio to save them.
How much longer?
It was going to be a miracle if it worked. I sincerely think that in the end, nobody expected that radio to work.
Their attempt to make contact with the outside world has failed. Nando and Roberto know that death is now inevitable unless they attempt the impossible, scale the mountain that stands between them and safety.
Put him down, Father. Put him down, Father. Guys, wait up!
They build a giant cross next to the tail section as a sign to any rescue planes. It's now the 28th of November, and they've been trapped on the mountain for 47 days. Nando plans his escape.
I had chosen December 12th to leave, because if you do not choose a date, you stay and stay. I told Roberto, we have to leave. Because if we wait too long, we will become too weak to escape from here. The preparation for the final expedition was a lot of teamwork, spectacular teamwork. Everyone gave it their best shot so we could be successful.
Nando and Roberto expect the trek to last for days. The greatest danger will be freezing overnight on the mountain. But the insulation found in the tail could save their lives.
Carlitos was in charge of sewing a sleeping bag with copper thread that we got from electrical material from the airplane.
Make sure you keep the wire tight, keep the stitch close together.
The glare shield from the cockpit is used to make sunglasses to protect Nando and Roberto from snow blindness.
Aristarch.
Yes, bruh.
Here.
To carry the supply of human flesh and water they'll need, clothes are converted into knapsacks.
Some gave their best clothes so that we could fight the cold. Everybody knew that this was the last chapter in our story. The expedition would prevail, or it was death for all of us.
In village after village, Carlos posts a cash reward for any news about a crash site and the whereabouts of his son Carlitos.
Estoy tratando de encontrar información sobre el avión que se perdió. Se los pasan a sus papás.
Yo siento que me transformé en un cartero.
I felt like a postman, bringing news from place to place. I knew that the more people that were worried about the lost plane, the sooner we would find it.
Before leaving the fuselage for the last time, Nando offers the remains of his mother and sister as food for survival.
Only as a last resort.
O sea, no solamente Nando tenía la valentía.
Not only did Nando have the courage to climb the biggest mountain in the world, he had the courage and nobility to authorize us to feed from the most sacred thing he had, his mother and sister.
Nando, let's go!
I thought to myself that Carlitos doesn't know how scared I am, or that I don't know where I'm going. I don't have the slightest idea, and I said, look, this could be very difficult, and we may not return.
On the 12th of December, as planned, Nando and Roberto begin their climb. They're joined by 19-year-old Antonio Vizentin. Right from the start, the climb to almost 5,000 meters is physically devastating.
What I remember most while we were climbing was my breath, how I had to breathe before I moved another step.
Nando and the others can feel the effects of the high altitude. The air is much thinner, and every breath they take provides much less oxygen than at sea level. This reduces blood flow to the heart and muscles. Eventually, this restricted blood flow can cause brain fluids to leak inside the skull. The brain then begins to swell, and if left untreated, the results can be fatal. Symptoms include fatigue, headaches, nausea, vomiting, and loss of muscle control and coordination.
You close your mind to everything that is not of that moment. I was totally concentrating on the next step, where I was going to put my feet, my hand. My whole life was planning the next 10 or 15 meters, and then the next 10.
It's now been weeks since the official Chilean rescue mission was called off. But the victims' families put pressure on the government in Uruguay to send up a special surveillance plane. High over the mountains, the plane's camera records an unmistakably human sign, a cross. The photos are developed at the Chilean Air Force Base. Jorge Massa and Carlos Paez examine them.
Look, this is a cross. This is a cross in the snow.
It's true. We've never seen a cross there before.
This is a sign that the boys are alive. I am right.
But the next day, Commander Massa received some new and disappointing information about the origin of the cross.
De informaciones que recibimos de Argentina, nos indicaban...
After speaking to officials in Argentina, we discovered that, unfortunately, the cross was actually made of instruments used to measure snow levels that would tell us how much water to expect in the summer.
The cross in the photos is not the one constructed by the missing boys. Once again, the rescue mission is called off.
We thought we were going to climb the mountain in one day and then see the valleys of Chile or the lights of a city. But it wasn't what we thought. It was much bigger and much more difficult.
No, for this! We'll see the foothills.
For 2 months, Nando and Roberto have believed that if they can get over the mountain, they'll descend into the green valleys of the Chilean foothills.
After climbing that mountain, I realized that everything we thought was wrong. We weren't in the foothills. We were in the middle of a mountain chain. There was no chance of surviving. Absolutely no chance.
The boys believe the crash site is in Chile, on the western edge of the mountain chain. But in fact, they're trapped in the middle of the Andes, east of Chile, in Argentina.
It was the most decisive moment of my life. I accepted that I was going to die in those mountains. I was not going to return to that plane. But dying up here seemed useless.
After 3 days of difficult climbing, they're demoralized, broken, and exhausted. But Nando and Roberto resolve to forge on. They've already sent Antonio back to the fuselage, allowing them to add his third of the food rations to their own. Now they must make their way down the mountain into the icy valley. Carlos Paez has not given up his search, despite the fact that his son Carlitos has been missing for over 60 days. Carlos rents his own plane to scour the mountains.
There were so many days and so many nights and so many tears when I was looking for them. I was putting pressure on myself to be the one who found the plane. With Christmas arriving, it was dramatic, because I had to return to Uruguay without Carlitos.
Nando and Roberto have been walking for days, and their muscles are cramping painfully from overexertion.
As the days went by, we started to feel weaker, mentally and physically.
I wondered what would happen if Roberto broke his leg, or if he couldn't walk anymore. Do I carry him, or do I leave him here? These are doubts that a person has, because we're human.
Porque no deja de ser un ser humano. Pero las montañas son muy lindas.
The mountains are beautiful. They're majestic. They rule in that place. They don't want humans there. When one is dying in those mountains, they transform into a truly horrible monster.
Seven days into their long trek, Nando and Roberto are barely able to continue.
I think I was hypnotized. You don't realize how hard what you're doing is. If I had stopped to think, I would have died. We were approaching our limit, a physical limit. It was a real low. There wasn't much life left in us.
It's been 9 days since Nando and Roberto left the crash site.
We had been living in a black and white world because of the snow and rocks. For me, going from snow to rocks was like crossing a line, a very important line, the line from death to life. We had hope.
A few hours later, they get the first real proof that they've returned to the land of the living.
Hey! 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 Over here!
Yo creo que el primer instante en
the first moment I realized that I might survive was when the man stopped his horse to look at us. And I said, this is the first contact with civilization. He will save us.
Este señor nos va a salvar.
The man across the river signals that he'll go for help. The next day, a group of horsemen carry Nando and Roberto to a local village. They get to savor their first real food in 70 days. Word spreads of the two plane crash survivors who've apparently cheated death. People can hardly believe it when the boys reveal that 14 more survivors are waiting to be rescued back at the crash site. The Chilean Air Rescue Service dispatches helicopters to rescue the remaining survivors. On the 22nd of December, there's a Christmas surprise for those who survived 72 days in the Andes.
Susie!
Carlos Paez is told that his son Carlitos is among the survivors. But after his epic 10-week search, he hardly dares to believe it.
la angustia de la espera del helicóptero fue tremenda.
There was a lot of anguish while waiting for the helicopter. When it landed and the dust settled, I saw Carlitos. He smelled of sweat and sacrifice and death. I hugged him intensely. I think that photo of us shows that moment very well, because it conveys the horror and the happiness at the same time.
Their reunion would probably never have happened were it not for Nando's determination to find an escape route out of the Andes. As Carlitos exits the helicopter, he embraces Nando.
I wanted to thank Nando in some way for what he had done. I hugged him. We fell to the ground. For the first time, I felt warm.
Only 16 of the 45 survived, huddled in a battered fuselage, weak with hunger and numb with cold for 72 days. Their tale is a true testament to the strength of the human will, and one of the greatest survival stories of the 20th century.